Good evening and welcome to The Checkpoint. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. Now, how has the COVID-19 pandemic impacted on people living with HIV? What is happening to HIV testing, treatment, and also counseling? What will the statistics be after this whole COVID pandemic? And how does the UNAIDS, which is the main advocate for global action against HIV, responding and also looking at the situation? Now, my guest tonight is a public health specialist and epidemiologist with an experience in postdoctoral, with an experience in HIV/AIDS. Among her responsibilities are to provide leadership and technical assistance to HIV programs. Dr. Kalusa Kiragu, UNAIDS Country Director in Uganda. Welcome and thank you for joining me.
Thank you very much.
Now, I want you to make us understand what is your own assessment of the impact of COVID-19 has had on Uganda's health sector in general terms.
I think it's raised a lot of, thank you very much for inviting me. I think COVID-19 has impacted the health sector quite significantly because COVID-19 is a disease.
Yes.
And the first response is within the health sector.
Mm.
It has done so by, and it's a brand new disease,
yes.
Which means people have to understand it, people have to learn how to test it, people have to understand the symptoms, people have to, the healthcare providers have to figure out how to isolate all the things that are now happening.
Mm-hmm.
Those are very, very immediate impacts, and it's happening at very rapid pace.
Yes.
Already we are dealing with the issues of the number of cases in Uganda, the number of cases at the beginning from the travel and all that. And ultimately, it does have an impact on the health sector because it means that healthcare providers are busy trying to monitor COVID-19 and trying to identify the symptoms so that they can isolate those patients. Fortunately for Uganda, the Ministry of Health has done a really, really good job and has been able to pretty much contain the epidemic.
Mm.
It is not the numbers that we are seeing in other countries, even though I think the last I read was 198 cases, I think, as of yesterday.
Mm.
I think all in all, Uganda must really be commended for how well it has managed to stave it off despite very difficult circumstances.
Absolutely. And of course, we're up to now, we have not lost any single individual.
That's another compliment.
Of coronavirus, whereas other countries around, Uganda are losing people.
Exactly.
And now, do you feel Uganda has the balance, the right balance between funding the health sector vis-a-vis other sectors of government?
I think Uganda has, the Ministry of Health funding for the health sector has not been the level that we'd have wanted. Abuja has guidelines, Abuja Declaration from recommends that 15% of the budget be allocated towards health.
Mm-hmm.
Uganda, it's something like around 7%, 8%.
Exactly.
So we are not where we would like to be. But I think Uganda has also been getting quite a lot of support from development partners,
mm-hmm.
has been getting quite a lot of support from within the private sector, has contributed a lot. More recently with COVID, you've been seeing, of course, a lot of donations coming to the country, donations from individuals, donations from the communities,
mm-hmm.
The business communities and others. So we think that that will help in dealing with the epidemic. Ultimately, probably the best way to ensure a sustainable funding is to have to support the health insurance scheme, because I think with strong health insurance, the national health insurance, that would be able to make it more sustainable, so that people can get care without getting too much out of it.
How does that actually help in the circumstances, the insurance scheme?
Well, if there was insurance, then everybody would be contributing, and that would reduce or flatten the risks, so that it's not only those who are unwell that are paying, but also everybody's chipping in, because at the time when you get sick, then you can get the care.
Exactly.
So that's how insurance works, basically.
Mm.
It spreads the risk among all of us, so that when I get sick, I can get the care, or when you get sick, you can get the care.
Yes.
But I can pay for you, you can pay for me, we can pay for each other.
Yes.
Not quite in in those direct ways, but also pooling the risk
so, and so reducing. So the environment the risk. Works for each and everyone.
Then it works for everybody.
And yeah. And in a democracy, you understand that issues of rights are fundamental. And how has coronavirus impacted health-related rights issues, especially to those living with opportunistic diseases?
Yeah, you know, the issue of rights at first was actually quite a concern, mm-hmm. because of just the decision making had to be done very quickly. The government had to make its decisions very quickly. And there will be people who will say that was sudden, but you're dealing with an epidemic. Yes. You're dealing with an unknown, something we didn't know. And fortunately for Uganda, it put its lockdown even before there was one case in the country. And that was the way to go. Stop it before it even comes into the country.
Yeah.
So that was very strategic. That was the right way to go. Of course, it meant that people could not do anything they wanted to do everywhere. Mm-hmm. It meant that they could not travel. Some of them were caught where they were, and they couldn't go either go back up country or people were, you know, found where they were. I know that there were issues of people who, you know, they were, you know, the police were quite strong.
Yes.
They were enforcing the law, and I still think they do enforce the law quite seriously.
Mm.
But the president also said to the country, and I've appreciated how often he has come to, you know, to remind us and to tell us and to share.
Well, where does this actually leave the universal rights? The inherent rights of human beings, the right to movement, the right to assemble, the right to...
Yeah, the right to assemble, the right to move, the right to... I think all those rights exist in the context of normal life, if you will.
Yes.
When you're dealing with an epidemic, then you have to change that. It's no different than if you were dealing with a flood. Your right to walk will be affected because of the, you know.
Mm.
So we have to understand in the context of rights. But I do think that things have stabilized, and I think it has become much better. Some of the challenges we had was for people living with HIV not being able to access their drugs.
Exactly.
That was a huge problem.
Mm.
It still continues to be a problem, but not as much.
As
because,
it used to be.
Yes, because people have found ways of getting and helping each other and coming together. The biggest problem right now is food.
Yes.
Food is, especially in urban areas.
Mm-hmm.
That is a very big problem. We've got very many children who do not have access to food, and they are going around asking for help, and that and it makes it very hard for them because they are living with HIV. Many of them
are
orphans.
The right to food, the right to, you know, should have been one of the fundamental rights that should be protected during this COVID-19.
It should be protected, but also it can be, these things take they take time to put in place.
Yes.
So the first thing was to lock down, and then the next thing was to put together the rest of the systems in place. Those did not come as quickly as
we
would have wanted, as all of us would have wanted. But was it the right thing to do? Yes. If they say if the house is on fire, first begin by putting out the fire.
You should not just lay the bed when the house is on fire.
Exactly.
But of course, a doctor, looking at fighting epidemics greatly depends on synergies and solidarity of different individuals and institutional effort. Do you see this happening with COVID-19 fight in Uganda?
I'm sorry, say that again.
No, because you as an epidemiologist, you know that fighting epidemics requires greatly depends on synergies and solidarity of different individuals and institutional efforts.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see this happening in Uganda? Do you see a concerted effort from each and every Ugandan, you know, assembling to fight against COVID-19?
I think everybody has been, in a way, co-opted to fight it because it's here. It's affecting all of us. Mm-hmm. The lockdown meant that you could not do, you know, the movement was constrained, yes, and all these things we were talking about. So in many ways, it's already affected all of us, and we've had to adjust ourselves and get ourselves sorted out. Mm. The issues, perhaps one could say, is in regards to the other parts of the government and how they are coming together and how they are working together. I know there's a national task force that is chaired by the Prime Minister that brings together all the multi-sectoral players, whether it's Ministry of Transport, whether it's Ministry of Health, Ministry of Internal Security, and all the other actors for who are involved in ensuring that the country is moving in the right place, in the right direction, the private sector. So I would say for Uganda, I think the collective effort is what has led to fairly low numbers of cases.
Yes.
So I would say it's working. Could it do better? Yes, of course, it can always do better. But I would say that the multi-sectoral aspect is working relatively well from where I sit.
And are you seeing individual Ugandans also participating in the fight against COVID-19?
Yes. And
should they have performed better, or are they actually performing to their expectation?
I think the Ugandans came and they listened and they paid attention and they followed the directives. All you have to do is just look around and see how very much the city was empty,
yes,
or, you know.
And it is still empty.
Oh, it's still relatively empty. I think the issues will be around when the lockdown.
Welcome back to Checkpoint. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. We are still with Dr. Karusa Kiragu, UNAIDS country director, trying to talk about the COVID effect and also how Uganda is performing in response against this pandemic that has put countries and cities on the lockdown. Doctor, before we left for a break, we were talking about other diseases diseases that have been affecting Uganda, HIV/AIDS, and also other disasters like floods and locusts. In your own assessment, do you think that we have been up to the task in dealing with these issues?
I would say yes. Again, if you measure with the kind of pandemic we are dealing with.
Yes.
Now, when it comes to things like locusts, there's been teams from MAIF and others who have been working to manage that.
Yes.
Again, that's just another biblical event, if
yes,
you will. Mm. I don't think we'd had that many locusts for over 70 years, I think. Mm. But they'd been working on it. They've been doing the spraying and the Energy Street was affected by the COVID,
yes,
the movement and so on. Mm. But that's work that has been going on, had been going on. Floods now, those are
natural hazards.
Natural hazards,
yes,
you know, and those are the things that tax the people, because those are not things that like that government can do that much to mm-hmm. prevent. Mm. You know, one can move communities up to higher ground, but sometimes it's not always possible.
Yes.
That one is a hard one. Mm. And I think the government is doing the best it can mm-hmm. under the circumstances.
Mm.
And then, of course, there is COVID. There is other diseases. Mm. There's HIV. There is NCDs.
Yes.
There's malaria. There is TB. All those have to be
in tackling such issues like, dealing with the impact of floods and also locusts, you know, getting to people's places, homes, getting into people's gardens, you find people being displaced as a result of floods and mm-hmm. other natural hazards, landslides, you know, around the country, especially in the eastern part of the country. You are also seeing rights of many people, mm-hmm. especially the right to shelter being, affected and mm-hmm. also being infringed on. I'm wondering whether there is that kind of a concerted effort by Uganda to make sure that the rights of citizens mm-hmm. are still maintained regardless of whatever is being dealt with.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and I think there are certain level at which the rights are not so easy to fully exercise because of the emergency nature of it. The example we were using was the movement, the right to movement.
Yes.
When the lockdown happened, people's rights to move had to be curtailed
yes.
at the cost of the public health impetus that forced this into happening. I think when one is dealing with emergencies, some of those things become very difficult to exercise right there then, but the point is to come back and restore those rights and make sure that as quickly as possible people can have their freedom
yes.
and their rights once again, which is what I think is happening in terms of easing the lockdown and talking about, you know, opening a few things now that the most critical acute phase has been dealt with.
But in dealing with this also, actually, Doctor, sorry, before you respond, you can clearly see that even the security forces sometimes may end up using excessive force, disguising as, you know, trying to enforce the directives issued by the government. Should actually anyone take an advantage of a situation of responding to an emergency and also end up violating people's rights?
No, and I think you raise a very good point. And actually, in fact, that issue was recognized by the president himself when he directed and said, you should not abuse people. Mm. You should not violate people's
yes.
Physical dignity because of just the way they. It was very vicious the way that they were enforcing. They were enforcing the law.
Mm-hmm.
In our case, we actually had a group of young men that we were trying to get out of jail because they were caught in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Mm.
So when the lockdown happened, they could not go home. And some of them were actually arrested in their own home.
Yes.
So some of those things happened, and fortunately they were released. But it is true that rights of people were violated.
Mm.
It's just it's a difficult balance when you're dealing with an emergency and when you need to take quick action. One of the rights, for example, was closing the borders. So it means that people could not travel in and out of Uganda.
Yes.
But that is a legitimate decision.
Yes.
So the rights are lost because we are trying to preserve health.
Yes.
And it's getting that balance.
So the line is, you know, very hard to balance. It's very hard to balance the two.
It's hard to balance.
Yes, when you're responding to emergencies and also trying to observe the rights of others. But then actually this brings us to the question of vulnerable people. Are you really satisfied on the level of engagement the government and, you know, is trying to do, especially the response towards COVID-19, especially by the vulnerable people, women and girls, when you talk about women and girls in this whole fight against COVID, are you really satisfied with the engagement the government is putting in place to make sure that their rights and, you know, they still get the benefits they're supposed to get because they are, you know, part of the vulnerable group that we're having?
Yes, that is true. We've been seeing actually increases in domestic violence.
Mm-hmm.
We've been seeing increases in maternal deaths.
Yes.
Some of these are because people were now put in an environment where they are not used to. For example, if all of a sudden a woman is trapped with an abusive partner,
yes.
Because of the lockdown, he cannot go anywhere,
then
it will be, some of the consequences will be those increases in domestic violence. But what we are noticing is that people are quite alert to these situations.
Mm-hmm.
Healthcare workers are being encouraged and trained or sensitized, according to the Ministry of Health guidelines, to identify these sorts of cases and be able to provide the kind of help that they can provide.
Yeah.
But it is, and these challenges are actually not limited to Uganda. In many countries,
the domestic violence cases are on the rise.
Exactly, is happening all over the world just because of the environment in which people, households,
have risen as compared to the ones, because we understand that also HIV AIDS created some kind of a rise in domestic violence. And you are seeing now COVID-19 creating the same situation.
Yes.
And are we seeing this coming to an end? Because we have reported so many cases of women being abused at home, mm-hmm. children being subjected to torture mm-hmm. by parents because of the environment that has been created. As UNAIDS, how actually do you think this should be handled, and how should government intervene to help?
Mm-hmm. I think government should, and it's already intervening, mm-hmm. Can intervene even more strongly to help by raising the awareness mm-hmm. and making it very clear that those are violations that are not tolerable mm. By responding to through the justice system and mm. making sure that violators of domestic abusers, for example, are met with the appropriate law and the mm. appropriate action through the police and the security apparatus. I think in terms of as well providing a way for women to communicate mm. that they are experiencing abuse, and sometimes it might just be being able to have a friend who can come and check in or something
yes.
like that.
Mm.
In some countries, they actually, when they go to the pharmacy, there's a code that they give, and that indicates that she's actually here to report
domestic violence.
She's not here to take medicine. Mm. She's actually here to report a domestic violence situation. Mm. And so the pharmacist will then call for assistance, and the woman will be able to get assistance. So there are different ways that can be done. There's some of the organizations, some of the community organizations mm. have shelters where women can go.
Mm-hmm.
But it is definitely a very, very challenging situation.
Is there a need for governments to sit down and also try to increase on the punishments given to the offenders? Because now the situation that has changed,
mm-hmm.
and some in so many countries, you'll find that some of these domestic violence cases are taken as petty cases.
Yes.
Now that the environment has brought the rise on the number of cases, isn't there actually a possibility for countries to come up and say, we are now doubling the punishments for the offenders?
Mm-hmm. I think you're very right when you said this is an opportunity. It's an opportunity for us to, because COVID is exposing a lot of challenges.
Weaknesses and gaps.
And weaknesses. And so this is a time to then say, now that this is a gap that we've identified,
mm.
We need to address it in this way and address it in a permanent way
mm-hmm.
and not wait for the next epidemic.
Exactly.
I definitely agree with you in terms of taking domestic violence as extremely seriously as it should be. The same with violence against children.
Mm.
It is a violation of people's rights in the most extreme.
Absolutely.
And the weakest. Mm. And that to me should be met with the strongest form of justice, the strongest form of punishment as there should be, and taken extremely, extremely, extremely seriously.
And pregnant mothers, because we saw a scenario where they also have to go to the district residence commissioner to seek for a clearance to go and seek for antenatal care. And these are issues that we need to have, because if you are a security personnel and you're looking at a pregnant mother, does she need actually to show you that she's going for treatment or not?
No, that yeah, some of those
the
things.
The pregnancy would be actually the clearance.
It should be visible enough for you to see. Although there'll be those ones who are early in their pregnancy,
yes,
like 4 months.
Exactly.
You know, the other one you cannot see.
Mm.
But I think what the programs are trying to do is just to make sure that's to limit the movement.
Yes.
So that we can control the disease.
Yes.
But at the same time, and I think the government has been very clear, pregnant women must get access
yes.
to care.
Mm.
I don't think there's been a debate about that one. I think
People with
disability.
Yes.
But actually, health services are pretty much available in the country. It's not just COVID has not frozen everything. What COVID has done is it has prioritized some health services.
Yes,
and but others are still available, and the guidelines by the Ministry of Health are very clear on that.
Well, when you look at how actually the Ministry of Health is dealing now with the services provided to people living with other diseases, non-communicable diseases and other infectious diseases, in your own opinion, do you think the ministry is still giving its best to make sure that even these people living with other diseases which are not COVID-19 related are also getting the support they require?
I believe the Ministry of Health is doing that. It has issued the guidelines that has indicated the high priority and high targeted health conditions.
Yes.
Because those still have to be addressed.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to address COVID and then have another problem tomorrow.
Mm.
So the services, from what we understand, are still available.
Mm-hmm.
And the Ministry of Health has been sensitizing health workers to make sure that and has developed algorithms to be able to make a determination as to how to interact and how to support a patient when a patient comes. So I would just encourage people to continue to seek healthcare, because those services are still available.
When you look at the way the Ministry of Health has designed different task forces to deal with these issues, is this actually the way any first promising country would be actually taking? Is that the path that somebody, you know, any country would be taking?
Yes, because you have to have several machines moving at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
You need to have the labs in place and functioning fully.
Mm.
You need to have the risk communication, health promotion, informing and educating people.
Mm.
You need to have the case management, making sure that when people come to the for healthcare services, they can get the services.
Absolutely.
You need to have the coordination from the national level down to the district and then the sub, so all those pieces have to move at the same time, and that's just within the health. We're not even talking about transportation, we're talking about security and other aspects. So this, all of these have to move and have to be coordinated, and that's really the only way to go, is to do it from a multi-sectoral point of view.
But of course this also goes back to the possibility of finding a vaccine for COVID-19. And I'm wondering, what's UNAIDS stand on efforts for developing this COVID-19 vaccine? Because we have had so many issues to do with there is one herb of medicine that was made in Madagascar, and you hear the World Health Organization is saying it's not certified actually to be given to people. What is UNAIDS stand on finding this vaccine for COVID-19?
Well, for us, again, let me just mention, UNAIDS is actually a consortium of 11 UN agencies that are working in HIV. WHO is part of UNAIDS when it comes to HIV, UNICEF, UNFPA, and others. So our effort, coming back to the issue around finding the vaccine for COVID, is very much along the lines of making sure that it actually happens and happens quickly.
Mm-hmm.
But it has to be the right kind. We cannot have herbalist that comes and says, I have discovered something. Because that happened in the days of HIV, and many people died. And many people, in fact, were prayed for and they stopped taking their medicine.
By holy pastors.
So all those lessons.
Holy religious leaders and also herbalists.
We know all those lessons. Mm. And so here with COVID, we should be very alert to make sure that Uganda gets the best. And the only way Uganda will get the best is if it follows through the Ministry of Health guidance.
Mm.
Uganda has very strong institutions. Whether it's UVRI, whether it's MRC, there's so many very, very, very strong institutions that will be able to assess all these medicines and will test them and give Uganda the right thing. So I think...
That effort start with herbalists? Because we have some African herbalists who can actually contribute towards the search for this vaccine.
Yes, and I think... if they have their product that can be tested by the Ministry of Health and can go through the rigor, then that should be, because it is true that some plants are actually medicine, but it's not to mean therefore one can announce that this is the one. It has to be tested. It's going to be consumed by people. People are going to trust it, and for that to happen, it has to go through the scientific processes of testing it.
Now, what is your take on HIV caregivers missing out on essential workers during COVID-19 lockdown? Because we saw, a list of, essential workers, including insurance people, including the media, including, utility companies. But HIV caregivers missed out on this. What exactly is your opinion on that?
Yeah, I think that's very unfortunate. And I think it has to do perhaps with the way Uganda has absorbed and dealt with HIV. It has absorbed people in, families,
in the communities. Yes. We have accepted them and we are living safely with them.
Exactly, and we are living with ourselves. To me, I think it is, they've become such a blended part of us that sometimes we don't even notice that they are doing the very, very difficult work of making sure that people are taking medicine, going to pick up medicine for them, making sure they have food. Some of those things have become sort of like just part of us that we don't even notice. But it's really important, and we've been pushing to say make sure that communities are involved, and by that I'm talking about communities that have been engaged in HIV and communities that have been contributing to HIV work, communities that have been advocating that they should be part of this COVID response. They bring a lot of lessons.
Exactly.
They were very strong in Ebola. For example, in my previous work in Ebola in West Africa, communities of people living with HIV were very, very powerful in forming the response there. We see that this opportunity here in Uganda, we should also harness the experiences of people living with HIV, and they are very, very strong communities that know the problem, that can contribute in a very, very meaningful way as to how we can address COVID.
But actually, some people say that there is an advantage in that. Looking at HIV, people living with HIV missing out on the essential list simply because, somebody was telling me it's a positive and it's a recognition that people do no longer fear HIV. And people have now appreciated the fact that HIV is no more dangerous as it used to be. And people now have appreciated the fact that they are living peacefully with people living with HIV. Isn't that actually a clear message that the fight against HIV is towards the end of it?
No, I think we've still got a long way to go in Uganda. We have, in Uganda, we have 1.4 million people living with HIV. But we have about 50,000 new infections a year, which is about 1,000 a week.
Yes.
So that's a very large number. So I wouldn't say that we have reached a victory with HIV because we've still got 1,000 new infections every week. Now, with COVID and all the things that's going on, you can imagine those rates could very well increase.
Yes.
HIV is an underlying condition which aggravates COVID or exacerbates COVID. TB as well is under some of those. And COVID is a lung disease.
Yeah.
TB is a lung disease. So, no, 500 people, I think almost 500 people die of AIDS every week.
Which is still a very bigger number as compared to that of COVID-19, especially in Uganda.
Exactly.
And of course, observers say that there is complete lack of customized training on these dimensions of other diseases in relation to other ailments and COVID-19. Aren't we destined for danger?
I'm sorry, I didn't
know. There are observers who say that there is complete lack of customized training and dimensions of other diseases in relation to other ailments and COVID-19. And this looks to be heading us to a danger.
No, I would say I think Uganda is managing its COVID challenge quite well. I know that they've been providing specific guidance to healthcare workers, and a lot of supportive supervision. The teams are moving across the country to be able to support at the district level and at the sub-district level to define the priorities, to define the approaches, and you've seen that even the Minister of Health herself has been very busy.
Yes,
been very
everywhere.
Active. Everywhere. Her team has been very busy, very active everywhere.
What is worrying us about that is that, it seems that the attention has been shifted to COVID-19. And actually, this may frustrate and also likely to affect the resource allocation to many other areas.
I wouldn't say so. We are the first case was in March, so this is May.
Yes.
We are 2 months.
2 months.
2 months going on to 3 months. Into dealing with a global pandemic in the context of Uganda. So the attention that it needs is the attention that it's getting. Mm. But at the same time, as I was mentioning, other services are available. Mm. Maybe they are just not, because of this new thing,
yes.
Maybe they are not visible. But it does not mean that they are absent.
Yes.
It just means that right now we are trying to put out this fire, but the house is still intact.
With fears that there could be corrupt tendencies within the system.
Well, that is something to always worry about, and I know Ugandans are very vigilant.
How should government actually handle this and also address accountability issues, especially in dealing with response to do, response against COVID-19?
I think government has strong accounting systems. Mm-hmm. But as well, I know that there's many watchdogs.
Yes.
That pay attention, community groups, members.
And looking out to.
Looking out for accountability. I know there's inspector generals and so on. It is important that people feel that the funding is used the correct way, that the donations, the many donations that are being received are being used the correct way, because the trust of the people needs to be maintained.
Doctors, we are winding up. Post-COVID-19 situation, of course, it could be here to stay for with us, and we must be prepared for that. Which advice would you give to people on how to deal with this? Because post-COVID-19 is a reality, and how better should we deal with this as we are winding up?
Yeah, I'll use the words that my friend Dr. Watiti used the other day at a meeting we were in together, and he said COVID-19 is about discipline. Mm-hmm. It is going to demand very high levels of discipline.
Yes.
Of all of us.
Yes.
The masks that we are wearing, it's going to demand of us not being able to shake hands.
Exactly.
It's going to demand of us not being able to sit even in the offices or at workplaces or at, we're having to go through a huge change. Mm-hmm. It will require all of us to contribute, because if we don't contribute, the price will be very high, and that price will be borne by all of us. Mm. So I would say, I would appeal to all of us to do our part and
yes.
take it seriously, because Uganda has a chance to completely stave it off long enough to get a vaccine,
yes.
Long enough to get a cure,
yes.
A medicine, for it, permanent medicines for it. Mm. But as of now, it will just demand that we really be very religious and be very disciplined about it.
We will have to be very religious and also disciplined about that. And then in the words of Dr. Karusa Chiragu, UNAIDS country director in Uganda, of course. Thank you very much for that wonderful insight. And of course, we appreciate your efforts in the fight against HIV/AIDS. And we hope and we still pray for you so that you can as well advance this fight even beyond HIV and also COVID-19. And of course, it's been The Checkpoint. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. And of course, I thank you for sparing time to, be here watching us on Urban Television. And of course, a repeat will be coming back in the morning. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. Stay on Urban TV.